with us. Come on. Is he worthy of praise? Yes, he is. He's worthy of praise. He's kept you thus far. Hallelujah. He'll keep you all the way. Come on. Magnify the Lord. Thank him for another opportunity to lift up your voice in worship and in praise. Hallelujah. Go ahead and share. Come on. Tell your family. Come on. Join in. Join in the worship. Join in the praise. Come on and receive a word on today. Come see what the Lord is doing here at Bethlehem. Hallelujah. Come on. Tell them. Join on in. We give God praise on today. Hallelujah. We give God praise for you. Hallelujah. We thank God for you joining in on today. Hallelujah. In this month of February, as we celebrate Black History Month, hallelujah, we thank God for another opportunity. Come on. Another opportunity to lift up our voices in praise, in freedom. Hallelujah. In liberty. Hallelujah. Lord God, you're worthy of glory. Lord God, you are worthy of praise. Lord, join into our, step into our worship. Step into our praise on today. Say what you want to say and do what you want to do, Lord God. We are yielded vessels, Lord God. Fill us up, Lord God, to overflowing, Lord God. I declare healing, Lord God. I declare peace over the airwaves. Have your way, Lord God. Have your way, Lord God. Come on, receive what the Lord has for you on today. Receive what the Lord has for you on today. Come on. We declare he is the everlasting God. He's a never-ending, eternal God. Come on, magnify the Lord. Magnify the Lord. Come on. Hallelujah. Put them hands together and give God a praise right there if you know he is the everlasting God. Come on. Hallelujah. You're worthy, oh God, of worship and praise. There's nobody like you, Lord. No, no. Salvation, whom shall I fear? Of whom shall I be afraid? The Lord is my light and salvation. Of whom shall I fear? Of whom shall I be afraid? I will wait on you. Are you willing to wait on him on today? Come on. I will wait on you. Trust in you. I will trust in you. The Lord is my light. Come on. And whom shall I fear? Of whom shall I be afraid? Come on. The Lord is my light. Afraid. Shall I be afraid? I will wait on you. Come on, declare that with us. I will wait on you. I will wait on you. I will trust you, Lord God. Come on, lift up your hands and worship and say, I will trust you, oh God.
I will trust in you.
I will re-
So
declare that today. I'm going to see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. I will remain confident in you, Lord God, and in your word, oh God. My hope is in you and in you alone, oh God. I will remain
confident in this. I will see the goodness of the Lord.
Family, this is the day that the Lord has made. Listen, I'm rejoicing. I'm certainly glad in it. Listen, I'm being blessed by the service, by this wonderful worship that's going on. I pray that you're being blessed as well. We thank you so much for joining us on behalf of the leadership of this church. We say thank you for tuning in. We know that God has meticulously ordered your steps to this broadcast at this time. So to that end, we know that there's something that's going to be said that's going to be a major blessing to your life. So at this time, we want to pull up and pause for the calls for a quick minute to allow you to become a virtual evangelist. Yes, you. We need you to do two things. We need you to like, and then we also need you to share. We need you to like and share simultaneously. Praise God. If you're watching on YouTube, you got about maybe 10 seconds or so to copy that link, send it out to Lottie, Dottie, and everybody. I'm excited about this word that's coming forth. Happy Valentine's Day to all of you. Listen, God is doing great things. People are recovering. Testimonies are coming in. Family relationships are being restored. I believe that the house that God is going to be blessed next is your house. It is your year to recover.
Hallelujah. We love you, Lord. We love you, Lord. Hallelujah. We love you and we magnify you. I declare, I love you, Lord, more than anything. Hallelujah.
I love you.
than anyone, more than anything, more than anyone, more than anything, I put you first, I put you first, oh God.
Praise the Lord, everybody. Praise the Lord, everybody. To the members of Bethlehem and our visitors that are streaming with us, we just want to take a few minutes to welcome you to Bethlehem. Is that all right? Come on, put your hands down. Come on. Come on, if you believe in the Lord for better, put your hands together. Everybody sing. Everybody sing.
Better.
Believe in the Lord.
Believe in the Lord for better.
Yes, hey, everybody sing.
Better.
Thank God.
Better.
In the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Say better.
Better.
Believe in the Lord.
Welcome to Bethlehem Baptist Church. Today's announcements are as follows. Have you downloaded the Givelify app? This app allows you to sow no matter where you are and no matter what time of day. As we know, when we sow into fertile ground, we can expect a harvest. This app will make giving easier. Remember, with Givelify, you can give any amount, anytime, and anywhere. So download Givelify, add Bethlehem as your church, and sow today.
Probably been hearing a lot about coronavirus disease 2019, or COVID-19. For most that catch it, the symptoms will be relatively mild. Those who are most vulnerable are the elderly and those with compromised immune systems or other health conditions. To help protect them and avoid spreading the virus, avoid handshakes and wash your hands for 20 seconds with soap and water. When you cough, cover your mouth by coughing into your elbow. Also avoid crowds and unnecessary travel and practice social distancing. If you have flu-like symptoms or have been exposed to COVID-19, stay home, avoid others, and call your doctors before showing up at their office or the emergency room. Visit BaptistOnline.org or call our dedicated hotline at 866-941-4785 for more information. Get better with Baptist.
Well, it's Black History Month, family. And so listen, we want to salute all of the pioneers of our ancestors that have done great things as it relates to our community to give us the rights and the privileges that we currently enjoy. But we also want to lift up the members of Bethlehem Baptist Church that are with us, that are Black History even now, that have done great things. We have so many members in our church, in our community that have done great things. And we want you to know that we appreciate you and we celebrate you in this Black History Month.
Ida B. Wells Barnett. 70 years before Rosa Parks, there was Ida B. Wells. Ida was born into slavery in 1862 and lost both her parents by the age of 16 due to an epidemic of yellow fever. At the age of just 22, Ida refused to give up her first class seat on the train and was dragged out by three men. She sued the railroad company and won $500, a considerable amount in 1884. But the railroad company appealed the Tennessee Supreme Court and got the ruling reversed. Deeply hurt by the ruling, but encouraged by the attention her case got after she wrote about it in a black newspaper, Ida decided to become a writer. After being fired from her teaching job for writing an article that criticized the condition of black schools in the region, Ida dove deep into journalism. She investigated and wrote about lynchings in Memphis until her newspaper office was burned to the ground. Her office might have been burned, but Ida never stopped writing about lynchings. She distributed pamphlets titled Southern Horrors and The Red Record, both about the horrors of lynchings supported by research. Ida B. Wells was also a suffragist. As a prominent black suffragist, Ida often clashed with the leaders of the U.S. suffrage movement, whom she believed were silent on the issue of racism and lynchings. Ida has influenced countless black feminist activists and was also one of the founders of the NAACP.
Hey family, it's that time again. It is that time again. It is time for our 2021 corporate fast. Listen, I am so excited. On February 17th, we're going to start and we're going to do our corporate fast. We're going to fast before the Lord and we're believing God for recovery in every area of our lives. You know how we do it. We're going to have a prayer focus on every day. We're also going to abstain from meats, from sweets, from starches, from sugars, from dairy products. But the good news is that Fridays at 5 p.m., hallelujah, until Monday, you can have fish on the weekends. Starting at 5 p.m., we can have fish. So listen, I believe this is going to be a year of breakthrough. I believe it's going to be a year of signs. I believe it's going to be a year of wonders. And most of all, I know that it's going to be a year of recovery. God honors faith. If you have faith the size size of a mustard seed, you can speak to mountains and mountains shall be removed. And I want somebody to know that you're going into agreement with God corporately with us as a family. You're showing to God that you have faith for God to recover in every area of your life. To that end, February 17, 2021 to April 2nd, which is Good Friday, we're going to fast before the Lord and we're going to believe God for recovery. The Bible says that the fervent, effectual prayer of the righteous availeth much. And to that end, we're always in prayer for our church family. We want Sister Carletta to know that we're praying fervently for you. She went in for surgery on this week, and so we're praying fervently for her. We're also praying for Sister Faye Salmon, and we're also praying for the Rivers family as they had death in the family. We're also praying for our very own Minister Walters, her sister that resides in Canada, has passed away. So we want all members to know that there's no earthly sorrow that heaven can't heal. And so we want you to know that we love you and that we're praying for you and that you're not in this by yourself.
This concludes today's announcements. For more information, please visit our website at www.BethlehemBaptistCovingtonGA.com. Also, like and follow us on Facebook at Bethlehem Baptist Church Covington GA. That's Bethlehem Baptist Church Covington GA. We will now have the word from the pastor of Bethlehem Baptist Church, Pastor Ronnie Thomas Jr.
Hallelujah. To God be the glory. This is the day that the Lord has made. It is one that we're rejoicing and we're glad in it. Hallelujah. We say to you, happy Valentine's Day. Pray that this day is one that is certainly blessed to you, that you're excited and that you're energized to it and that you're spending time with those that you love. And in the event that you don't have a loved one, you don't have a boo in this season, hallelujah, I want you to know that Jesus is your Valentine. Praise God. Come on, let's pray. Father, we love you, God. We thank you for all things. God, you're worthy of the praise. You're worthy of the honor. You're worthy of the glory. We're excited now, God, of another day. We're excited, God, of this season of recovery. We're excited, God, that you've literally canceled the reservation to a cemetery. God, which let us know, God, the best is still yet to come. So, God, we thank you now, God, that our existence is a testimony. Testifies, God, that eyes have not seen nor have ears heard the great things that are on the horizon for us. So we love you. We come against anything, God, that's not like you. We come against any distraction that will stop us from receiving the word even now, God. So we thank you for the prayers that have been prayed, the songs that have been rendered to you. Now God is preaching time. I realize that I'm not my own, that I was bought with a price on Calvary. With that being said, I pray, I beg, I ask now that you would decrease me to nothing. Please raise your spirit to everything. Thank you, God. Let me think with your thoughts and speak with your words. God, I pray now, I beg now for pulpiteering power, spiritual stamina, effective communication to the saints. Have your way even now, God. Do what you want to do as long as you want to do it. We give you spiritual power of attorney, God, to move and to bless, God, to say, God, whatever you so desire to do, God. Hide me behind the illuminating shadows of Calvary's cross. People will see none of me but all of you, God. Thank you now, God. We'll be so careful to give your name the praise, honor, and the glory. Please now give us the growth while you get the glory and the matchless, the miracle-working name of Christ. Pray now, God, that you'll preach me to the point of your pleasure, till heaven is happy and that hearts are satisfied. We bless your holy name even now. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Well, God bless you again. We greet you in the joy of Jesus. There's a word that we want to share on this morning. Two verses this morning. John chapter 13, commencing at verse 34, then subsequently concluding at verse 35, reading according to the NIV version of the Bible. However, whatever version you have at your disposal is a version of the Word of God. And the Word of God reads, "A new commandment I give you," Jesus saying, love one another as I have loved you. So you must love one another. By this, all men will know that you are my disciples if you love one another. I'm going to lift it in your hearing once more. A new commandment I'm giving to you, Christ says, speaking specifically and expressly to the disciples. He says, love one another. He says, as I have loved you. He says, so you must love one another. By this, all men will know that you are my disciple if you love one another. And my brothers and sisters, with that thought in mind, certainly needing your prayers, God's power, and the aid of the Holy Spirit on this morning, I want to preach on this Valentine Day. What's love got to do with it? Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. Hallelujah. What's love got to do with it? What's, do me a favor. Come on, if you're sitting beside somebody, if you're sitting beside your boo, hallelujah. Come on, just say, what's love got to do with it? What's love? Come on, you didn't say it the right way. Say, what's love got to do with it? Come on, if you're sitting beside yourself, always encourage yourself in the Lord. What's love got to do with it? My brothers and sisters, on May 1st, 1984, music icon Tina Turner released a song that many of us know and that many of us love. What's love got to do with it? In that particular song, she says, what's love but a secondhand emotion? She says, what's love, hallelujah, but a good old-fashioned notion? Who needs a heart when a heart can be broken? While on the one hand, it makes for great music, on the other hand, it is some people's personal mantra. What's love got to do with it? Some people would argue, in fact, emphatically, that love is not enough. However, I want to forthrightly differ from those of you this morning that may be under the opinion that love is not enough, because I want to suggest emphatically that love is enough. In fact, love is enough to secure, love is enough to save, and love is enough to sever. I'll say that again, that love is enough. It is, in fact, enough. In fact, I want to pause for the cause. And would you look at somebody if you're sitting close to them, because it's Valentine's Day, and spread love and to let them know that love is enough. Pastor, what is love enough to do? Love is enough to save. Love is enough to secure, and love is enough to sever. When you look at John 3:16, it says, for God so loved the world that he did something, that he gave his only begotten son. We see and we discover that love is an action, that love is recorded in congruence with giving, that God so loved the world that he gave what is in fact near and dear to him. So that suggests to us, my brothers and sisters, that love is enough, that love is enough to secure. Love from John 3:16, we discover that love is enough to secure our salvation. Love is enough to save us from the punishment of sin, and love is enough to sever the penalty of sin. Love is enough. And whenever a person suggests perhaps that love is not enough, perhaps they don't understand the essence and the totality of love. Because when you look at this particular word, love, this four-letter word, L-O-V, you'll discover that the Greeks, this word was so powerful that the Greeks used four words to express this one word, which was love. Again, that the word love is so powerful, the word love is so expansive, until the Greeks used four words to express one word. When the Greek talk about love, they mention it in four ways. They mention it in terms of eros. Eros love, eros love. I'll give them to you, then I'll unpack them. They mention it in terms of eros love. They mention it in terms of sorge love. They mention it in terms of filial love. And they mention it in terms of agape love. Eros love is a love that is an intense passion. Help me, God. It can often be misconstrued with lust, that eros is an intense passion. You see him, you see her, and it does something to you. It's an intense passion. It's a longing for that. That's Eros love. But I want to caution somebody relative to Eros love, because you can't build your house on Eros. Because what you see today is may not what you see on tomorrow, because Father Time, hallelujah, has a way of catching up with Mother Nature. So you can't build your house on Eros. Preach, Pastor, I'm trying to do the best that I can. There's Eros love. Not only is there Eros love, but there's sword love. This love shows the relationship or the bond between a parent, hallelujah, and a child. There's sword love. But then there's filial love. This is a brotherly love. This word filial, give us the word Philadelphia. It's a brotherly love. One that is near and dear to their heart. One, a person that you have not talked to for months or perhaps some time, and whenever you talk to them is as if you've never missed any time. That's filial love. But however, in this text today, in the love that Jesus is referring to, and the love that as Christians that we operate in, the John 3:16 love, is agape love. This is the highest form of all love. This is the love that Christ loved with. It is agape love. This type of love, it endures injury. This type of love endures insult. This type of love is the love that's mentioned in 1 Corinthians 13, which incidentally, we'll go there shortly. This is the type of love that's mentioned and that Jesus posits in the Bible, agape love. So the question that the sermon asked that I'm going to answer is, what does love have to do with it? Love has everything to do with it. And in a very real sense, this is what Christ was positing to his disciples. Jesus, in his farewell address, expressed the true essence of love. Please understand, my brothers and sisters, Jesus is about to depart, and there are many things that Christ could have said. There are many principles that Christ posited to his pupils before his departure. However, one of the principles that he posited to his pupils was that of love. In his farewell address to his disciples, the key word he used was love. In fact, when you look at the book of John, the word love was used, watch this, 12 times in chapters 1 through 12, and watch this, 40 times in chapter 13 through 21. Jesus placed great emphasis on love. And so the word for the disciples and the word for us today on this Valentine's Day is, what does love have to do with it? Love has everything to do with it. In fact, when you look at these two verses teach us three truisms as it relates to love. That number one, this verse shows us, watch this, here it is, the mandate to love. Would you do me a favor really quickly and encourage yourself if you're sitting beside somebody or if you're sitting by yourself and say, there is a mandate to love. That Jesus, number one, point one, Jesus gives us a mandate to love. Look at verse 34. If you will, Jesus says, a new, help me God, commandment I give you, that you what? Love one another. Church, you have to check out how awesome this is. Jesus says, I'm giving you a new commandment. That word new, we must not gloss over that. We must pay particular attention to that, because in this context, the word new refers to not in quality, not in quality, but in time. This word new refers to, not in time, but in quality. This word new refers to not in time, but in quality. Because essentially what Jesus was saying, he was comparing, watch this old to the new. Jesus was saying essentially that the new was superior to the old. In fact, watch this, Jesus says, in the Old Testament, to love your neighbors. However, Jesus comes now in the New Testament and Jesus says, love your enemies. Jesus is positing that there is a mandate to love, that Jesus says that there is a mandate to love. This word new, it refers to new in quality, not new in time. Jesus compares and contrasts these two with the old and the new. The old says love your neighbors, love your neighbors. The new says love your enemies. In fact, Jesus went further in Matthew chapter 5, verse 46. He says, if you love those who love you, he says, what reward will you get? He says, even the tax collectors, watch this, are doing that. Jesus gives us a mandate to love. Now, note, if you will, church, the mere fact when Jesus says, love your enemies, that tells us and teach us we have to love those, watch this, that even are not lovable. Lord have mercy. Preach, Pastor. I'm trying to teach and preach this thing simultaneously. That we have to love those, watch this, who are not lovable. We even, watch this, have to love those, watch this, that cry, holy, 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 but are filled with hell, hell, hell. You got to, sometimes got to love the hell out of them. Jesus says that we have a mandate to love. Would you type in the comment section for me and say, I'm mandated to love. In fact, the only reason that I'm able to love people that are not lovable, the only reason I'm able to, watch this, love people that I don't even like, help me God, or don't like me, watch this, is because I got a mandate on my life to love. It's not that I'm a weak wimp. It's not that I'm a pushover, help me God. It's not that I'm a sucker. It's not that I'm Boo Boo the Fool. It's not any of that. I've got a mandate to love you. So that means even when you're not lovable, I've got to love you. And watch this, that means I've got to love you. But so even when I don't respect your person, I've got to respect your position. What do you mean, Pastor? Sometimes I can't respect you as a person because of the way you act. I can't respect you as a person because of the way that you conduct business, the way that you carry yourself. But when I can't respect you as a person, I've got to respect your position as a child of God. I've got to love the hell out of you. Lord have mercy. Somebody, this is blessing your life right now, because here it is, the only reason that you're able to love. People think that there's something wrong with you. People think that you're gullible, and people think that you can be bamboozled and hoodwinked and take for granted. No, baby, it's not that. It's just I have a mandate to love, and because I got a mandate to love, I'm going to love you. Y'all not talking to me on today, because I got a mandate to love. Instead of, watch this, hitting you, watch this, I can hug you because I got a mandate to love. Preach, Pastor, I'm trying. Help me, God. Instead of, watch this, cursing you, I can speak to you and say, I love you in Jesus' name, because I've got a mandate to love. Instead of rolling my eyes at you, I can pray for those that despitefully use me, because I got a mandate to love. Would you do me a favor really quickly and say, I got a mandate to love. God has called me to love you in spite of your ways, in spite of how you lie, in spite of how gossip you are, how much you gossip, how messy you are. God has commanded me to love you. I've got a mandate to love. Oh, God, would you do me a favor one last time? I'm trying to run on to point number two, but would you say, I have a mandate to love? God requires me to love. He requires me to love. He requires me to love, but let me help you. Let me help you. God has mandated us to love, but you got to love a certain way. You got to love people, help me God, without letting them walk all over you. Yes, God. You got to love people without letting them talk about you like a dog. You got to love people without letting them mishandle you. You got to love them a certain kind of way. Come here. Can I go? Can I grab this? I'm from the parable of the prodigal son. Here it is. The father taught us how love is. The father taught us how tough love is. Because here it is. The son comes to the father. Note, if you will, the father represents his strength. The father represents his sanctification, and the father represents his substance. The prodigal son goes to the father and he says, give me, help me God, the portion of mine now. Essentially, he was saying to the father, he was just saying, you are good as dead to me. That was the ultimate insult. Please understand, in Jewish custom, the only child that time that the son could receive was when the father had deceased. So the son going to the father said, give me mine now. Essentially, here it is. The son was saying to the father, you're as good as dead to me. But note what the father does. Nowhere in that particular pericope do we see the father arguing with the son. Nowhere do we see him change words with the son. He gave the son what he asked for, because he says, Gracias, I got to love you with a tough love. He says, I got to love you without letting you run, without running after you. I got to love you without begging you. I got to love you without pleading to you. I got to love you without asking you to love me. Here it is. Sometimes you got to have tough love. And I don't know who I'm talking to today, but God is telling me to tell you, you're made in the image of God. Here it is. And so you got to understand. Help me, God. I got to love you a certain way, because God has mandated me to love you. Watch this. There's a mandate to love. Would you do me a favor and say, I've been mandated to love. That's why I'm loving, because I have been mandated to love. However, God, watch this, has not called me, watch this, to be a proverbial doormat. God has not called me, help me, to be your whooping board or your sounding or your whooping stick. Help me, God. God has not called me to be picked out, to be picked on, but God has mandated me to love you, and I've got to love you even when you're not lovable. And the way that I can love you when I'm not lovable is because what's on the inside of me. Would you do me a favor and say, there's something on the inside of me that allows me to love when situations don't call for love, when circumstances don't call for love, when individuals don't call for love. I can love regardless of that. And so here it is. Jesus teaches us what love has to do with it. Number one, that there is a mandate to love. Do me a favor and say, there's a mandate to love. But not only does Jesus show us the mandate to love, but Jesus, I'm in verse 34, Jesus shows us that the model to love. Jesus in verse 34 shows us the mandate of love. He says, a new commandment, help me, God, that I give you. But not only does he show us, watch this, the mandate to love, but secondly, he shows us the model to love. I praise God for Jesus, because not only does he give us a mandate, but secondly, he gives us the model. See, it's one thing to have a mandate, but it's another thing to have a mandate, but have a model of the mandate. Watch this, if you will. Jesus said, he says, as I have loved you, you must love one another. Jesus says, as I have loved you. The question then is, how has Christ loved us? Christ has loved us, watch this, not with, help me God, eros love, not with filial love, not with swords, but with agape love, the highest kind of love, the love that endures injury, the love that endures insult. Jesus loves us with, watch this, agape love. He loved us so much that he went up the Villa Dolorosa to die and to be crucified for sins that we would continually commit. Y'all not talking to me. He loved us so much until he gave up everything that he owned. The Bible says that he humbled himself to the form of a servant in Philippians. So he came owning everything and gave up everything that he owned. Jesus gave his back to the cross. He gave his side to the spear. He gave his head to the crown. He helped me, God. He gave his clothes to the gamblers. He gave his hands to the nails. Help me, God. He gave up his mother to John. He gave up everything that he had out of love. So that's how I have to love you. I got to love you with the love of Christ. I got to love you with a forgiving spirit. I got to love you with a forgiving heart. I got to love you the way that Christ has loved you. It's the model to love. Tell your neighbor, it's the model to love. Watch this. 1 Corinthians chapter 13, which most of us affectionately know as the love chapter, teaches us a few things about love. Let me go there very quickly. It teaches us, number one, watch this, the worth of love. It teaches us the ways of love. It teaches us the warrant of love. And it teaches us the winning from love. 1 Corinthians chapter 13, verse 1 through 13, teach us about love, teaches us about the worth of love, teaches us about the ways of love, teaches us, watch this, about the warrant of love, and it teaches us of the winning of love. Watch what it says in verse 1 through 3. It teaches us the worth of love. Paul is writing to the church at Corinth. Watch what he says. He says, if I speak in the tongue of men and angels, but have not love, come on. He says, I am a resounding gong or a clinging cymbal. He says, if I have the gift of prophecy, he says, and can fathom all mysteries and knowledge. He says, and I have faith, watch this, that I can move mountains, but have not love. He says, I'm nothing. He says, watch this, if I give up everything that I have, help me, God, to the poor, and surrender my body to be burned in flames, but with without love, I'm nothing. Help me, God. He talked about the worth of love. But watch this. Here is what I want to dial in on. He talked about the ways of love. In 1 Corinthians 13, verse 4 through 7, he talks about the ways of love. He says, love, watch this. Look at the ways of love. Here it is. Love is patient. Do me a favor and says, love is patient. Type in the comment section. Y'all help me, God, write while I preach. He says, love is patient. He says, not only is love patient, this is the ways of love. He says, love is kind. He says, love is patient. Love is kind. He says, it does not envy. He says, it does not boast. It is not proud. It is not rude. Love is. He says, I'm in verse 5. It is not self-seeking. It is not easily angered. It keeps, watch this, no record of wrong. Love does not delight in evil, but it rejoices with the truth. It always protects. It always trusts. It always hopes. It always perseveres. This, beloved, the ways of love is the measuring stick of love. If you tell me that you love me, here it is. I should be able to measure your words of what you say against the word of God. In 1 Corinthians chapter 13, verse 4 through 7, if in fact you love me the way you say you do, that means you should be patient with me. If you love me the way you say you do, you should be kind with me. If you love me the way that you say you do, you shouldn't be envious of me. If you love me the way you say you do, I'm in verse 4, you should not boast in what you have. If you love me in the way you say you do, you shouldn't walk around proud with a big head. If you love me in verse 5, the way that you say you do, you shouldn't be rude towards me. If you love me the way that you say you do, it's not self-seeking. You're not out for yourself all the time. If you love me the way you say you do in verse 5, you're not easily angered. You don't get mad about everything at the drop of a hat. If you love me like you say you do, you don't keep records of wrong. You don't remember what I said to you or what I did to you or how I hurt you back in 1980 or 1990. You don't remember what I said to you a year ago. Watch this. If you love me, according to verse number 6, love does not delight in evil. But watch this. Love rejoices with the truth. Watch this in verse 7. If you love me the way you say you do, watch this, you will protect me. Y'all not talking to me. If you love me the way that you say you do, you can trust me and I can trust you. If you love me the way you say you do, we have hope and I have hope. If you love me the way you say you do, you can persevere through trouble, trial, and tribulation. So here it is. Paul teaches us about love, the ways of love. Would you do me a favor and ask somebody, type in the comments section if you're sitting beside somebody. Come on, if you're not too mean, ask them, how are you loving these days? Oh gosh, are you loving? Is your loving kind? Is your loving patience? Is your love absence of envy? Is your love not boasting? Is your love not proud? Is your love not rude? Is it not self-seeking? Is it not easily angered? Does it keep record of wrong? Love, help me God, does not delight in evil but rejoices in truth. Is your love protecting? Is your love trusting? Is your love hoping? Is your love persevering? So watch this. Paul gives us the ways of love, but then he shows us the warrant for love. Watch this. Here it is. Love. Watch this. He says it never fails. What's love got to do with it? It has everything to do with it. Would you note right there in verse 8? Here it is. Paul says love never fails. That was so good, he had to put a period behind it. He says love never fails. I'm talking to somebody right now. You need to know where there's love is, you will not fail. Because the Bible says perfect love casts away all fear. That love never fails. Agape love never fails. fails. When you say I'm the recipient of a failed marriage, I'm the recipient of things that have happened. Well, if there's agape love, help me God, love will not fail. So in fact, God has done you a favor, that God has just hooked you up, and that your rejection, watch this, was simply redirection to a place of agape love. Please, Pastor, I don't know who I'm talking to right there, but I need to pull up really quickly. It's Valentine's Day. Half of us are rejoicing, but half of us got a heavy heart. But God wanted me to let you know on this day, help me God, that you may celebrate this year by yourself. But God says, if you celebrate by yourself, just rejoice, because you got to learn how to affirm yourself. I don't know who I'm talking to today, but somebody, when you get off the broadcast, help me God, go to Kroger, go to Walmart, buy yourself some flowers, buy yourself some candy, get the best face you can and put it in there. Help me God, put on some clothes, get yourself together. Help me God, get you some cookies and milk, and watch you a good movie. And when you're done, go in the bathroom, shut the door behind you, and affirm yourself. Say, mirror, mirror, hold the wall, who's the finest of them all? And don't wait for the mirror to speak back, but you say, you are, because you got to know love is not enough. She cannot bullshit. You are fearfully and wonderfully made. The devil is a liar. God has another chapter for you. But God wants to know how faithful you'll be in this season. Would you do me a favor and say, love is enough? Because he loves me, I ain't going to keep crying and stay crying. Because he loves me, I ain't going to be hurt and stay hurt. Because he loves me, I ain't going to be down and stay down. Because he loves me, I'm not going to be depressed and stay depressed. Because he loves me, recovery is mine. Would you do me a favor really quickly right there and say, love is going to bring back everything. Because he loved me, I am recovering. Oh gosh, I got to finish this sermon. I may can't finish this today. Ooh, I may have to preach this another time. Watch what it says, Mark. Let's go ahead and go, Mark. It's Valentine's Day. We ain't even got to finish all of this. Oh, God, but when you look at this, Jesus says, my brothers and sisters, watch this, that love is enough. And somebody's asking, what's love got to do with it? But love has everything to do with it. Would you do me a favor? I feel like preaching on Valentine's Day. Oh, would you do me a favor and go up and down your house and tell everybody, I love you with the love of God. I love you in Jesus' name. I forgive you for everything that you've done. Yes, you might have hurt me, might have made me cry, might have made me second guess my very existence, but I forgive you because I got a mandate to love. The Bible says, love your enemies. Oh my God. So that means I got to love you when you're not lovable. I gotta love you when you don't want to be loved. I gotta love you when you don't understand what I'm releasing to you. I gotta love you when you take my love for granted. I gotta love you when you don't want my love. I gotta love you when you think that you can do better. I gotta love you when you think that I'm not worthy of loving you. I gotta love you because that's what the word says. So would you do me a favor and turn to a neighbor and sing, neighbor, I've got to love you. I've been mandated to love. I got a new commandment, not new in time, but new in quality. You see, prior to, I used to only love those who love me. I used to only love when you're doing what I wanted you to do. But now, the Lord has allowed me to get a subsequent word for the next season of my life to let me know that I got a mandate to love. I gotta love you even when it's hard. I gotta love you even when it's difficult. I gotta love you even when it's tough. So would you do me a favor and say, what's love got to do with it? It has everything to do with it. That love is enough to secure. Love is enough to save. Love is enough to sever. So not only
sure I have a mandate to love. But then the Bible says, I got a model to love. I got to love you like Christ loved me. I got to give up some stuff. If I love you, I'll give up some ways. If I love you, I'll give up some habits. If I love you, I'll stop doing things that hurt you and offend you. If I love you, I won't talk behind your back. If I love you, I won't criticize you. If I love you, I won't doubt you. Would you do me a favor and ask yourself, what's love got to do with it? It's got everything, everything to do with it. So here it is. Jesus says, you got a mandate to love, but not only you have a mandate to love. Jesus says, I'm giving you the model to love, that you got to love as I love you. But then Jesus says, you got a mandate to love. You got a model for love. But then there's a manifestation of love. Would you do me a favor and say there's a manifestation of love? The Bible says, by this will all men know that you are my disciple, if you love one another. Would you do me a favor and read it with me? There's a manifestation of love. There's evidence of love. By this, all men will know that you're my disciples, that you love one another. So that means not how much money you make, not how many degrees you have, not how many cars you drive, not how much scripture you quote, whether you speak Greek or Hebrew, whether your suit is black or your dress is white, whether your shoes are shiny or your head is big, but not all, not how long you've been in the church or at the church, but by this men will know that you are my disciples. So would you do me a favor and say, is there love? Is there love in your heart? I can tell if you love, because one thing about love is hard to fake. Either you love me or you don't. So do me a favor, for the last time for real, turn to that neighbor and say, neighbor, love has everything, everything to do with it. There is a mandate to love, but not only is there a mandate to love, there is the model to love. Jesus says, as I have loved you, not only is there, oh Lord, a mandate and a model, but then there's a manifestation of love. In other words, you got evidences flowing out of your life that say and show you are a child of God. You got evidence in your life. By this, the love you give, men will know that you are my disciple. Would you help me close this message? It's love of the day. I gotta talk about the ultimate sacrifice of love. The Bible says that Jesus came to his own, yeah, his own received him not. They led him up off the hill. They hung him high. They stretched him wide. He hung his head in the locks of his shoulders. And the Bible says, he died. He died. He died. And he kept on dying. Oh, all night Friday, he kept on dying. Oh, all night Saturday, he died. He died until the earth began to reel and rock. He died and kept on dying until the sun sun refused to shine. He died and kept on dying until dead men got out of a grave in Jerusalem and walked. He died so much so. Yes, God, until the centurion standing by had to eulogize and say, surely this was the Son of God. But the Bible records early Sunday morning, he got up with all power in his hands, and he got up loving you. He got up loving me. And because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Because he lives, I can love those that are not lovable. Because he lives, I can love those that are full of hell. I can love the hell out of you. Would you do me a favor? Let me borrow one. Turn to your neighbor and say, I made up in my mind from this day forth, I'm gonna love you because I got a mandate to love. There is a model for love, and my love is a manifestation of my discipleship. Would you do me a favor and say, I've got to love you. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I'm finished. To God be the glory. What's love got to do with it? Has everything to do with it. I'm bothered. When people say love is not enough to me, that suggests that you don't understand love. And I get it. It's hard to express something that has not been expressed to you. It's hard to give something that has never been given to you. Hallelujah. It's hard to play out something that you've never seen. But guess what? Today, the Lord says, whether you've been the recipient of love, whether you've experienced love, whether love has been given to you, you have a model. And that model, the ultimate model, is Jesus Christ. That you can love with agape love, regardless of injury, regardless of agony, regardless of insult. You can love. We have to love. We got a mandate to love. A new commandment, he says, I've given you. That you love your enemies. A new commandment. We've got a mandate to love. But then he shows us the model of love. He says, as I've loved you. We've got a mandate. We got a model. But then there's a manifestation of love. Our love gives us evidence that we are disciples of Christ. That it is the hallmark of your identity in Christ, that you can love somebody else. No greater love than a man have than this, to lay down his own life. That means if I love you, I'll do some things differently towards you. And watch this, it's a mark of maturity. It's a mark of maturity. Paul says in 1 Corinthians, he says, the old things, he says, when I was a man, when I was a child, I put away childish things, but when I became a man, I thought as a man, and I did as a man, which suggests to us that there is a mark of maturity as it relates to love. Love, watch this, it hallmarks your identity as a Christian. But not only does it hallmark your identity as a Christian, it shows a level of spiritual maturity in Christ that you can love. And if you have a spirit of love in you, folk don't have to tell you how to treat them. Talk to me. Folk don't have to tell you how to handle them. But because, watch this, out of love, you have a spirit of empathy. And help me, God, you know how to handle people because the Spirit of God is speaking to you, is impressing upon you. Hallelujah. That you can't do to what others do to others what they've done to you. That you can't be to them how they are to you. Hallelujah. That's what love is. That's what love is. Love is love. Agape. Agape love. Agape love. Come on, let's pray. Father, we love you. We thank you now. We thank you for all things, God. We thank you, God, for now.
your spirit that abides. Pray now, God, that this word will fall on the fertile ground of our heart. It would, in fact, be our next and newest reality. So we love you and we thank you, God. Let us know that love has everything to do with it. That is, in fact, the hallmark of our identity as a child of God. So we love you and we thank you now. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Well, to God be the glory. To God be the glory. Listen, the doors of the church are open. If you're out of the ark of safety, if you don't know Jesus and the free pardon of your sin, this is the time now to come and commit to him. The Bible says, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. Watch this. Without the shedding of blood, there could be no remission of sin. The sin problem had become so bad that the sacrifice of bullock and goats were no longer sufficient. It's no longer sufficient. So then there had to be a ransom. There had to be an atonement made. That atoning Christ, atonement of Jesus Christ, gave us right, hallelujah, to the tree of life. Gives us a right, hallelujah, to secure salvation. Jesus has done the work. His sacrificial atonement and death and subsequent resurrection has given us the ability to secure our salvation with a decision. It's as simple as ABC, admitting, believing, and then confessing that Jesus Christ is Lord. And that day, your salvation is sealed. So somebody, I'm urging you now, that the Spirit is impressing upon you now, hallelujah, that this is your time, this is your season to accept Christ as your Savior. Listen, you can comment below, you can inbox us, you can call the church, and we have persons that will walk you through the plan of salvation that will assimilate you to our ministry in the name of Jesus. To God be the glory. To God be the glory. Listen, if you need a church home, hallelujah, I want to be your pastor. Hallelujah. We want to push you to that place that God says you can be, so you can have everything that God says that you can have. Be everything that God says you can. You need a covering in this season, and this is a great body to connect with. So we love you, and we thank you so much for joining us. But we pray, hallelujah, if you don't have a covering, if you don't have a church home, that we're in opening this invitation to you even now, that you can join us in while we're virtual, hallelujah, and when we come back in person, hallelujah, we're going to greet you in the joy of Jesus. Hallelujah. To God be the glory. Hallelujah. We're moving on in our services. There is no worship presentation complete, experience complete, without the presentation of a gift. And so to that end, we set aside now this time for you to give back a portion of what God has given to you, knowing the promises as it relates to your giving and how God loves a hilarious giver, one that gives with a hilarious heart. So come on, when you give to God, God's going to give it back to you, pressed down, shaken together, running over, that men are going to give unto you. Hallelujah. So as you're preparing that offering, I want you to attach an expectation to that seed. Don't sow it haphazardly, but attach an expectation to this seed, what you're believing God for. Bible says, cast your bread upon the water, and many days it shall return to you. So to that end, here it is. I want you to attach an expectation to this seed. And it is, in fact, a seed. And you're releasing it. You're sowing it as seed. But it's going to come back to you as fruit. I'm believing that it's not going to be any kind of fruit, but I'm believing, God, that it's going to be exponential fruit in the name of Jesus. So God, we love you. And we thank you for all things. Let us pray. Father, we thank you now for these, God, that are giving. We thank you now for the harvest that will come, the great things that will yield from this, that this seed will be the one that will break the back of the enemy. So, God, we thank you now for it, God. Pray emphatically, God, that you will withhold no good thing from them, God. Bless them in the city, in the field, when they come and when they go. In the matchless, miracle-working name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Hallelujah. Well, to God be the glory. To God be the glory. To God be the glory. Listen, we thank you so much for joining us this Wednesday. Come on, type in the comment section. Wednesday, our fast begins. I want everybody to type it in the comment section. Our corporate fast is beginning this Wednesday, February 17th. Listen, I'm so excited. Our corporate fast is beginning Wednesday, February 17th, and we're going into April 2nd, which is Good Friday. And of course, on Good Friday, we're going to have a great service on Good Friday. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. To God be the glory. Our ministers, hallelujah, they're going to be delivering the seven sayings of Christ. It's always a phenomenal time here in our church. Our ministers come together and they break down the word of God and they present it to us, the seven last sayings of Christ, that's from Christ on the cross. That's going to be on April 2nd. But in the meantime, we're fasting. We're fasting for the Lord. This is, in fact, our year of recovery. And so we're believing God. We're coming together corporately for 40 days, and we're going to pray fervently, knowing that God is able. There are going to be prayer focuses that will come out. Those will be listed, hallelujah, on our Facebook page. You can check out the page, and you can see the prayer focus for that particular day. And those things are going to be listed. And so we pray that you would join us for this fast. Don't let the enemy cheat you out of any blessings. Certainly you're not going to let negative talk or anybody talking negatively cheat you out of it. This is about you in this season. This is about your recovery. Truth be told, you've endured enough. You've lost enough. And when you were losing, when you were enduring, when you were in pain, hallelujah, those persons that may speak negatively against fasting to the Lord, hallelujah, they weren't there. Don't know your struggle. Don't know your story. But you've got to get it back. You've got to take it back. So listen, when we're coming together as a family and we're going to fast, please spread the word to everyone that you know that is a member of our church, that our fast is, our corporate fast is starting February 17th, which is Wednesday, this Wednesday, and then we're going to conclude on April the 2nd. Listen, you know how we fast on the weekends at 5, starting at 5, you can have fish, hallelujah, not shellfish, not shrimps, anything like that, crawfish, nothing like that, hallelujah, but fish, praise God, certainly not fried. Listen, we're abstaining from fried foods, we're abstaining from sugars, starches, hallelujah, those carbonated drinks, those things that are not to the glory of God, that are things that are 100% natural from the earth, hallelujah. And so we're praying, praying fervently for everybody. We're praying for your strength on this. You can do it. Find an accountability partner that you can pray together, and you can get through this. We will get through this. To God be the glory. To God be the glory. To God be the glory. Well, on this coming Wednesday, it's going to be Ash Wednesday. And so we're going to take a moment. We're going to take a quick break from our Bible study series. And my best friend, one of my best friends, one of God's best gifts to my life, Pastor John Daniels, is going to break the bread of life from the Outpouring Church down in Orlando, Florida. Hallelujah. So we praise God for him through technology. God has allowed he's going to come to us from his sanctuary, and we're going to record it. We're going to play it right here on Wednesday. So that's going to be a great word that's going to empower us, that's going to take us, hallelujah, into this season of fasting in the name of Jesus. That's going to empower us on the journey. So it's going to give us a word from the Lord. And so I'm so excited for that. So I ask that you would tune in on this Wednesday as we go before the Lord. Well, God bless you. God bless you. We love you and we thank you for watching and joining us on this day. Come on, let's receive our final prayer and benediction simultaneously. Father, we love you. We thank you. You're worthy of all praise. You're worthy of all honor, all glory. We pray now that you withhold no good thing from us. Every good thing that comes to our mind, please let it come to pass. Everything that our hand touch, let it be blessed, God, in the matchless, the miracle-working name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Amen. God bless you. God bless you. Happy Valentine's Day. Be safe. Hallelujah. Remember, COVID is still out there. So be safe. Be safe. Be safe. Celebrate safely. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Jesus is your Valentine for somebody. Hallelujah. God bless you. I love you. Recover. It's your season to recover.